Sitting down, I get less confused that way. I've got this new gizmo that's just a couple neodymium magnets, but I keep forgetting how it works, and it's just one of my complaints. Depend on the kindness of you know, random sequences. And I discovered a sort of a fellow traveler recently in, there's a collection of, well, I guess it's all of them, should be more than a collection, but less than a book of, the correspondence between Robert Lowell and Elizabeth Bishop. Robert Lowell being somebody that I love to read, and Elizabeth Bishop being somebody I'd never heard of, except in Robert Lowell, who had dedicated more than one poem to her. she was a friend of this, they both were, of the Sitwells. We, you know, who we all know so well. I only know Edith Sitwell because of her face, which is dreadful. Just impossible to look at. And this is only in a photograph. The photograph terrifies. What was it like to know Edith? Edith is coming, Edith is coming. I'm going. She drew her eyebrows starting about here and then back over here somewhere. She might wear, you know, something like a bear's paw at an angle off of her sort of funny looking head. If you're alone a lot and you eat a lot, you're going to run into Edith Sitwell. Anyhow, Elizabeth knew this woman, I think, better than did Robert Lowell, and mentioned that apparently she spent a lot of time with her brother, Osbert. What should we name our son? How about Osbert? How about Bob? I don't want to dig too much of a hole for myself. They're just irresistible people. Yeah, they are. At any rate, they lived outside of London in one of the nearby jungles in a fabulous architecturally rare structure resembling a home. And they filled the place with, I mean, apparently they were either related to or were a nobility or had a lot of money, because the place was full of 18th and 17th century, well, 18th century furniture. I don't think there was furniture in the 17th century. Just horses and turnips. Pull up a turnip and have a seat. So apparently it really was a wonderful place to see. You might find Ezra Pound there lounging on something built in 1722. And one day Osbert went out into the jungle and brought home a beaver. He found a beaver somehow managed to bring it home. Edith sort of made a little container for it, and I don't remember all the details. And they went out, maybe for the night, maybe for a week. And when they came back, they opened the door to the fabulous 18th century living room of their house, and there was nothing left but the beaver and a dam. Apparently, the beaver had knocked over a vase of flowers, and the water, which was there on the floor somewhere, had excited the beaver. And it made a dam out of every book and pillow and piece of 18th century furniture that Edith and Osbert had. That's all I have to say. Julie's house, the place I used to live. I climbed the steps and tried the door and let myself in. The kitchen clock I used to watch had stopped at 5 to 5. A photograph I'd never seen. A car came up the drive. I stood outside the kitchen door when she turned her head. I said that I was back to stay. She laughed at what I said. She said that I'd grow old, believing I was what mattered most.
Thank you.
sense. It's hard to play. It's a weird kind of knuckle buster because there's nothing particularly, you know, rough about it. I may have written it after hearing, I think the first name is Tom, not sure, bass player, Tom Burns, who has played both with Chet Baker and with Stan Getz. Preferred Chet Baker's playing, but not his company. And, Ruth Young said it was really hard to separate, to figure out how finally to separate his gift from him. I don't know, I like people like this. I stay away from them, but and sometimes they stay away from me. Friend, another bass player, back in the day when he was doing this, going the same route as Chet Baker, was sitting somewhere with a wad of heroin or whatever it's called. A quart of heroin? I don't know. And they had no way to administer it, and neither one of them would get anything out of it if they snorted it. So Chet took a can opener, dug a ditch in his arm, and poured a quart of heroin in the ditch. Well, it's entertaining, isn't it? And it's just, it's a lot of ways to approach a problem. My first drink of alcohol, I made myself, which is, I think, more benign than digging a hole in my arm. But in the course of things, I nearly killed my dad. And I not only had my first drink, but also my first attempt at quitting drinking. Don't ever make Raisin Jack. I was in the seventh grade, had a horrible thirst, and we had a substitute teacher in our Oklahoma history class in Muskogee, whose name was Hank Dreadfulwater, which was told you right away that probably just as much as us, he was not interested in the history of Oklahoma. He had enough Oklahoma to last him several generations. But surprisingly enough, he was a very cheerful substitute teacher, and he just flat out said, "We don't want to hear about the Sooners, do we? We don't want to hear about the land rush. You know? Let me tell you about Korea." And so he... And my favorite part of Korea was Hank Dreadfulwater in his tent on the slope of a hill somewhere with a bunch of other soldiers around, and a tent, one or two tents below him, that blew up one night, killing the three guys in it who had buried a 50-gallon drum of Raisin Jack under their floorboards. Of course, what I carried home from that was how to make Raisin Jack. Made some in mason jars, put it in my dad's garage where it blew up. My dad went in that garage two or three times a day that I could count. It may have been more than that, just to hide. Because when I went in, first I smelled what had happened. And then I saw shards of mason jar sticking out of beams, and it was a wooden garage. It made three perfectly unreliable, as far as timing at least, grenades. It had very little to do with it. There was a little bit of Raisin Jack left in a heel that was still sitting on the cross beam where I'd put my, where the brewmaster had put his, ferment. And so I tasted it, and that's when I quit drinking. But 4 cents. Is what, Tom Burns, I said, what was it like playing with Stan Getz? Because he loved Chet Baker's playing. He said, oh, Stan just kept playing licks. And I thought, geez, I wish, And he said, plus he was just a mess, I didn't like working with him. And I've heard that before. Zoot Sims was asked what it was like playing with Stan Getz, and Zoot said, oh, Stan's a great bunch of guys. Some great quotes out there. Artie Shaw once said, nothing gets better. Artie may have dug a couple ditches himself, a line like that. Tom Burns was in, I hope that's his first name, was in New York. They had some time off. Stan Getz was in Paris. And Burns got a call from Stan one night from Paris, collect from Stan. Well, Stan, how are you doing? We're going back to work. Well, blah, 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 blah. And he said they talked for about half an hour, and then Stan fired him and hung up. So 4 cents is what Tom Burns had left after paying the phone bill. Stan's call. Actually, the tune has nothing to do with what I just told you. And neither does the title, but I just liked the 4 cents. It just had a ring to it. Now I know why. It's the only connection I need. I need to stop this right away. Okay, I'm just... keeps sneaking up on me. Maybe my head's shrinking. Cluster chords that really take a hand at, with a reach like this. When I decided that I was going to play this piece, I found the sheet music in a book written by an Irishman named Mongan about a guitar player named Snoozer Quinn who died in New Orleans of TB. How about that? I mean, you know, name dropping is bad enough, but dropping a lot of names nobody's ever heard of takes some nerve, you know. I know Snoozer Quinn's grand niece. She plays roller derby in New Orleans. You can look it up. So I got the sheet music and I started reading this stuff and I thought, whoa, I'm dumber than I thought about this. I've got to be reading this. This isn't possible. I'm reading this wrong. So eventually and wisely, I gave up. A little while later, I ran into Pat Metheny just to drop another name. And we were talking about something or other, and I said, you know, I tried to play Moonlight in Vermont. I got the sheet. Something's wrong, and I'm sure it's me, but I, and he said, no. He said, you can't play it. It's impossible. God, that made me feel good. And then he showed me how he had worked out a way to play it, which was really diabolical, but much safer, involving, you know, using harmonics to fill out the... don't worry, I'm not going to attempt that. This is non-toxic. Passed and heckled by three canoe loads of Girl Scouts during my journey. You on my paddle? What are you doing? Are you from around here? Children, I don't know, 10 to 12. How do you defend yourself? All you have left is innuendo and sarcasm, and double up time. But you're talking to 12-year-old Girl Scouts. They're impervious. Still hurts.
Thank you.
You can buy two of these.
Good one.
People ask me why I don't have a band. Are you kidding me? I got it from my dad. He was even cheaper than I am. World's greatest tightwad. He's incredible. That everybody messes with. It's just open to that. You know it when you're fooling with it. That it's okay. That you're not going to lay claim to it. I remember what that is. See, I played last night in Newark, Ohio, and then drove here today. That's my excuse. Kid, like Son House and Fred McDowell, John. I didn't meet John, but I met and got to talk to John Jackson, the greatest exponent of a guitar style called Piedmont. Not just guitar, but being represented these days by a group called the Chocolate Drops, who wanted to know everything that I knew about John Jackson, because that's one of their, big people. And I had to tell them that we talked about calluses. I'm sorry, but that was it. And so I told him what he told me, which was that he hadn't washed his left hand in 20 years. Because you wash it and the calluses tend to degrade a little bit. So he said, I use alcohol. And I thought I would try that. And the next thing I knew, I had calluses as big as my shoe. And if I tapped a doorknob wrong, the callus would fall off. And you'd hear this dink. And that was your career, bouncing on the floor. And so I told them what Stanley Watson had told me, who taught Davy Graham how to play. Here's a couple more names. I moved to the States and taught off and on under a pear tree in Rochester, New York. Died one day when he was hit from behind by a poultry truck. He was on foot. And I asked him about the calluses when I was touring with the Joy of Cooking. Why do they fall off? He said, when you fret, you shouldn't see any wipe under your nail. You're just squeezing it too hard. Works. Sam Chapman told me to eat nothing but peanut butter and jelly sandwiches on white bread and Kool-Aid, which is what he was eating at the time that he was telling me this in a parking lot in Missouri. And he said, you'll live to be as old as I am and as healthy. Back then, that didn't sound good to me at all. Bo Diddley carried his own food on the road and he boiled all of it. If it was a banana, it was a boiled banana. How does it work?
It's more trouble than it's worth.
Oh, yeah, almost. There's a kind of explosion we've been having every time I did this without it, I think. I'm into the power to weight ratio, and this also kind of violates that. I believe that's your point. I'm going to sneak up on the end of the set with a piece that was written for a wedding. A couple friends of mine who played have told me, sometimes more than several times, that I don't have to play the kind of joints that they've got to squeeze themselves into for the money that they make, blah, blah, blah. And, that's not true. I still play weddings, I still play funerals, I prefer a funeral any day over a wedding. Weddings are so tense, you know, somebody, somewhere, sooner or later will ask you to play as if you could just whip it out, Pockle Bell's Cannon. And I mean, I'll admit that the weddings now are for friends, and I go for the food. But I have jobs very similar to that, that where everyone is a stranger to me, and I do them I do it because I can't resist playing. It's almost embarrassing to say that, but I'll just about play anywhere. You fall down, I'll run over and throw you a tube. I just get a big kick out of it. But sometimes it does blow up in your face. Weddings, often enough, it blows up in your face. Again, funerals, nothing. You know, you're not going to disappoint anyone. Moments was playing a library opening in Albuquerque. This was only about, I mean, it was about 15 years ago, I'm guessing. I mean, I will say that they paid me my usual fee, but that's where their investment in the entertainment stopped. The stage was a sheet of plywood laying on a hill, kind of a small hill. So that, you know, I had to just stay really still. Because, you could just sail right down into the crowd. It was Father's Day, and there were lots of kids there and lots of fathers. And I was playing away, thinking, is this weird or what? And a child, I guess he was, I'm going to say he's about 10 years old. I finished the tune, he'd been standing there, you know, with his grenade or whatever he had. I finished the tune and I looked at him and he said, "Can I play?" And I said, "Well, no." And then there was this sound that came out of the Father's Day crowd. Like nothing I've ever heard. I mean, I was in the Navy, I didn't hear stuff like that. It's a kind of a growl. It really was. It's just every one of them is like, oh, Jesus. And it multiplied, you know, by many dads upon many dads. It's a sound that just chills the marrow in your bones. So I still suffer for my heart. This is tune that I'll close with here. It was written and it became what I think is a lot of musicians' nightmare, which is that the couple who the musicians know should not be getting married, and they weren't the only ones. All their friends do this. This is in Nashville. Everybody knew each other, and everybody knew what a horrible mistake this wedding was. Well, they approached Eddie Reeves and Alex Harvey and said, asked them if they would write a song to celebrate their wedding. Oh, sure, we'd love to do that. You have to say that. You have to say, what a lovely baby. I'm going to hand you this. Did you ever know Edith Sitwell? You have to say, oh, isn't it? How sweet. And then they said, well, thanks. And would you play it at the wedding? Oh. Okay, so I'm convinced it's where the tone of this thing comes from. It's over the top. It's also one of the greatest things to play rhythm guitar on that I've ever heard. As always, it's a privilege to play it. It's especially great to be back here. This is our 20th anniversary. been good. Ring, ring, and voices ring, but a happy tune, anybody could be a singer. The sun comes up across the city, and I swear you never looked so young and pretty, and handles stand upon the stage, preacher band.
Thank you.